I'm Thatcher, and we're here at the Thatcher Building for Biological and Biophysical Chemistry in the Curie Club. And in the next 90 minutes, we're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to try to get you excited about the world of science and especially about the world of chemistry. Now, normally, this is done in a capacity room with all with people lining in the aisles, but because of COVID, we have to do it by Zoom, and so we hope that you'll be very patient with us. Because of Zoom, though, we do get some advantages. For example, you're going to have an ability to give some comments by chat, and if you have questions, you can put those in the chat, and we will do our best at the end to try to get all those questions answered. We're also going to have a theoretical chemistry film festival in the spirit of the Sundance Film Festival. So we're going to give you three videos with some scientists that do some experiments, and then you're going to be able to have a chance to vote and say which one you like the best. And then I understand we're going to do some have some videos with some experiments that are a little bit too dangerous to do in this setting, you'll be able to see those on the video. So I am so excited to get started. Let's introduce our stars. This is Dr. Janis Louie. How are you?
Great, how are you, Tom?
To see you. And Dr. Tom Richmond, great to see you.
Hey, Tom.
You know,
flanked by two Toms tonight.
That's right. You know, I was so excited. I think I saw this 2 years ago. It was at the Henry Eyre Building or whatever. And I said, I just want to try to get a seat. And now I'm actually in this room with you two. And I'm
just
really
excited.
You're
going to be part of with experiments. We're going to
we're going to negotiate that. But I wanted to ask you, since I'm kind of representing the studio audience, what is this Faraday lecture all about?
Well, Tom, did you want to talk about the history, and then I can tell a little bit about how it started at Utah?
Sure. So Michael Faraday is a name that kind of scares students in physics and chemistry, but he was a great English chemist who discovered how to make the first electric motor. And a lot of chemistry things. He was the principal scientist at the Royal Institution in London for many years, although he started from very humble beginnings and was almost a servant to the Royal Institution before they realized that they had a real gem in Professor Faraday. And he actually gave lectures in the 1820s called the Christmas Lectures. That's why we do this in December. Where they tried to explain new discoveries in chemistry to a lay audience. And in particular, I think Faraday delighted in getting children excited about science. And so we're going to be in that spirit tonight. We're going to actually do a couple experiments that Faraday developed. You can see there's candles out front because his first Faraday lecture was called The Chemical History of the Candle. But that wasn't the first Faraday lecture here at Utah, was it?
No, it wasn't. So Jerry Driscoll and Ron Ragsdale initiated the Faraday lectures here at the University of Utah. You know, back in the day in the 1800s, going to the Faraday lectures or the Christmas lectures was a black tie affair. You really had to be someone special to get into one of those shows. And so we thought, you know, let's bring that excitement here. And so Ragsdale and Driscoll brought that here. They did it for two decades before passing the baton. We're, Tom and I, are actually the third group, and we don't plan to stop anytime soon.
Well, that's great.
So how do we start this sort of lecture?
All right, well, let's get going.
Well,
I think
usually
you're
we kind of blow stuff up, right, Tom?
Yeah.
I don't know if we can blow stuff up on camera.
You know,
though,
we have a block U here, and we'll get to cheer a little bit tonight, but we also have a special kind of block U that I don't think even the athletic department has. And let's see what we can do with adding a little energy to these candles.
Whoa.
Woo! Doesn't look like there was a fire alarm above us, so we're okay. But that was I hope came through well on the video as a really energetic reaction using something called gun cotton.
Yes, so we have some cotton here. You might have some of this at home in your bathroom, maybe to dab some ointment on an injury. Now, normally when we light regular cotton to a flame, it burns, but certainly not as spectacularly as we saw the block use. So we'll put this here. Dab it out. And so it is definitely flammable. However, if you modify the chemical structure of the cellulose in the cotton and add nitrate to it, and so all of the cellulose within this cotton has been modified or enhanced, if you will, so that there is nitrate all over. But check out the difference.
Woo! Whoa.
Big difference from the slow burning to the flash that we see. And speaking of flash, I'm going to actually ask Tom to come here. We have some special paper. You might see magicians use this. And really, we know that all magic is really chemistry. Tom, why don't you hold these tongs?
Tom, you can hold that with your hand, can't you, Tom? Give it a try.
How about one with a tong, and we have more. So we'll start one with a tong.
Okay, I just saw the explosion a little bit there.
but this is safe?
Sure.
This one is safe.
All right.
Yes,
very good.
But definitely get your glasses on.
All right, and I just take it right up by the flame.
Right to the flame.
Okay.
A little bit in the middle, right? So
yeah, that's safe. That's safe. I can handle that one.
So this is called flash paper, and this is what magicians use to impress you and show their magic. But really, it is very similar to what we call gun cotton, or what we like to say TNC, like TNT dynamite. And so this is modified paper that has, let's say, less nitrates on it. Would you like to try it with your hand this time?
Okay,
sir?
Well, you just said dynamite right before you gave me this, but we'll try it here. So I just put it right up to the light again.
Flame.
Okay, here we go.
Whoa!
Yeah, there you go, yes.
I think my hand's safe. We're okay.
So we've been playing with heat and light. Let's remind ourselves about how we light up the world. And see how science has improved that over the years. I guess we want to first think about Faraday's candles, don't we?
Yeah, so we had energy come from the cotton, and we're going to have lots of lights, but really, if you think about it, in the 1800s, they didn't have electricity. They didn't have lights. What type of energy did they use? Well, they simply used a candle, and we're going to show you that a candle's really not the most efficient way of generating light.
Yeah, let's see if we can draw something our candles.
All right. Mine's blank, sir. Is yours? How about yours?
Yep.
Okay, blank. All right.
Nice and clear.
All right, here we go. Right, so not so close but to the candle, but somewhat close. Nope, mine's not.
Okay. She's a perfectionist. Mine may be a bit of a mystery, but you know, one thing, you probably see the roses here, and I think we may have a chance to talk about a big football game coming up.
Oh, yes.
Sometime in the future. And who are you rooting for, Janice?
You, of course.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no. Oh, Tom. Well, we have a replacement tonight. Tom, I think you're going to have to step in for Dr. Richmond here, because clearly he's rooting for the wrong team.
You know, and one of Faraday's very original experiments was interesting about what happens when you blow out a candle. And what we're going to do is...
Thank you, sir.
Take our candle and put a little sheath around it. Sort of contain, and you can probably see that there's some soot coming off. And then we're going to blow our candles out and watch really carefully to see how the candle relights.
Right, here it goes.
I'm going to try. My candle's a little farther away.
Wow.
I think I'm going to do that one more time.
Me too.
Just to see if it's reproducible. And so, in fact, that same soot that drew letters on our paper, we were also able to relight the candle from above. And believe it or not, there's when people study that soot carefully, they actually find one of the molecules that is really emblematic of modern chemistry that's called buckyball. It's 60 carbons in the shape of a soccer ball. And some of that is being produced and destroyed right in that candle flame.
Are you okay, Tom?
I think so.
Well, Tom just gave a clear demonstration of why lighting our house with flames might not be the healthiest, right? The soot gets into your lungs. And so what we've moved on to now are light bulbs. And so I have one right here. I'm going to actually walk around towards Tom this way. And we can see that this light bulb, they're both the same, has been cut off. So now it's exposed to air. Normally, light bulbs have a tungsten wire, and it's completely covered with glass. And in an inert atmosphere, you don't have any oxygen going through. Why is that the case? Well, if you expose the tungsten wire, where all the energy is, to air while you're trying to have light, this is what happens. You have light, oh no, there's smoke, and boom, the light fizzles out. And that's because the tungsten wire gets oxidized from the oxygen that's in the air while it's burning. However, as long as we can protect that tungsten wire from the oxygen, it will continue to burn. And of course, one way is to do that is to cover it in glass and in an atmosphere. Well, we cut the glass off, so I can't grow glass back, but what I can do is submerge this light bulb in liquid nitrogen. So that's nitrogen gas, cool down, super cold. I will not stick my finger in there. It is oxygen free. And so if I put the light bulb in there, there's no oxygen. So when I turn on the electricity, that light will stay on indefinitely until I choose to take it out. And now it's just going to be a matter of moments. In fact, we can already see the smoke sizzling, and there goes the oxidation of that tungsten wire.
So even that neat light bulb under liquid nitrogen generates a lot of heat. And of course, the way we light things now is with light-emitting diodes that generate light by a completely different mechanism. And so these, you want to touch that?
Oh, wait. Oh, look at that. So safe.
And so what we have are some light-emitting diodes. And it's interesting, you can probably see there's kind of an orangish glow right now. And we're going to see what happens when we freeze one of these. I guess I'm the control experiment. Kind of boring.
You're not boring, Tom. Not at all.
And if you can, pull that out. And if you compare these two, the one that's cold, you can see is much greener. What we've actually done is shrink the light-emitting diode just by a tiny bit, but that changes the color of the light that's emitted. And if I do that to my other one, probably something similar will happen as it cools down. Each one is slightly different, but you can see now there's a pretty nice green glow.
Mine's starting to warm up, so it's getting a little bit more yellow, going back towards orange.
But that's sort of the basis. And the great thing from an energy saving standpoint is producing light from a light emitting diode doesn't produce much heat. So it's about 5 or 6 times more efficient than an incandescent light bulb.
Absolutely. Tom, it's been really amazing talking about the practical uses of chemistry. Now, really, I say all the time, chemistry is all around us. You can taste, see, smell, touch, or feel it, that's chemistry. So anything cool in the world is definitely chemistry. We saw how you can modify paper and become a magician and use flash paper. We saw how incandescent light is used, as well as more energy efficient light. Now, here's a different type of energy. Again, we're going to do an oxidation. We're going to pour an oxidant into this this unoxidized compound, luminol. And if it were dark, you could see much better. But I think you can kind of tell that a light has been given off. It's luminescence. And that really comes from something you're familiar with, the glow sticks. So you'll notice that for a glow stick, Tom is breaking it because he's mixing two chemicals together. One oxidizes the other and gives off luminescent light.
Oh, beautiful. Sounds good. So it, you know, it makes me wonder too, does a diamond, about these, are there limits of these chemical reactions?
You know, chemists always try to push the limits, I think it's fair to say, in discovering new molecules, mm-hmm. trying new reactions. If you tell a chemist this won't work, she'll say, I'll make it work.
Yes.
And, but I always wondered, and in fact, in one of the Faraday lectures in England, I saw them burn a diamond. Do you have a diamond on you, Tom?
No, I'm sorry.
I'm wearing silicone, actually, now, so.
Oh, well, you know, I've always wanted to burn a diamond, and.
You know, that you must be taking inspiration from Faraday's mentor, Hugh Davies. He was the pioneer or the first person to prove that diamond was the same constituent, made out of carbon, just like graphene. And nobody believed him until he did this experiment.
And you want to see this, don't you? See a diamond burning. And so we have a video of this that we actually took down in the university's glass shop. Kevin, our glass blower, heated up a diamond with his torch, and we dropped it not in liquid nitrogen, but in liquid oxygen. And so hopefully you'll have a chance to take a look at that, because it is a...
Sure, and just see what happens.
Here it goes. Bright red.
Sure. And just see what happens.
There it goes.
Now, so it's going to be on your screen here, and the question is, where are you watching from, Utah or beyond? So we're going to give you 30 seconds to answer that, and I guess we'll
at the end. We can chat a little bit during the poll question, I think. That, the sound probably comes through.
Okay.
Because, you know, I know one of the answers to the question isn't on there, but I want to shout out to two future scientists, Jake and Andy, who live outside of Seattle. I know they're watching right now. And they've been in my lab with lab coats, and actually they kind of liked liquid nitrogen as well.
Who doesn't like liquid nitrogen?
Absolutely.
And so I think one of the maybe byproducts of this is we might be have our widest ranging audience ever.
Absolutely.
For the Faraday Lecture.
Are you ready? All right, now we're going to talk about the color and chemistry.
Hey, Tom, did you hear the answer to that question?
What was it?
80-20.
Is it 80-20? Yep. 80% from Utah, but 20% outside of Utah. Thank you for joining us.
Maybe they're Ohio State fans.
Oh, no, I don't think so.
Okay, now we're talking about color, right? And chemistry is all about color. So you've got some demonstrations on color now.
Yeah. So okay. We were working with something called liquid nitrogen. Here's something else that's called dry ice. And dry ice is just solid carbon dioxide, and I'm adding it to this flask. And in the flask is an acid-base indicator. And as the solution becomes more acidic with CO2, you notice it went from green now to yellow. And if I really push this along by adding a really strong acid, hydrochloric acid, let's see what color we get.
Oh, our favorite Whoa. Color.
You know, and the only problem is, isn't that Ohio State's favorite color as well?
You're still on Ohio State. We've got to try to convert you here.
So let's go the other direction. Now we're adding a base. This is sort of fancy Drano, just drain cleaner. And what you're seeing that bubbles off is just condensed water vapor because the dry ice is cold. And perhaps you can see that it's getting kind of a dark purple color as it bubbles away. But what will happen, since the dry ice is there, it will slowly neutralize the solution. Maybe I'll throw in a little more. And if we're patient, looks like it's lightening up a little bit. And we're ready for a good sort of Halloween mystery with smoke and fire. And in fact, this is the way a theater makes smoke when they want to, with a little more sophisticated machine. When they want it as part of their play. And so that's lightening up, but if we're not patient enough, why don't we finish off back with red?
Wonderful. Now, Tom has demonstrated that colors change from when subjected to either acidic or basic conditions using what's called a universal indicator. And it's called a universal indicator because it shows a color regardless of if it's acidic or basic. I'm going to scoot this potion over just a tad. And this universal indicator can be blue, yellow, red. It's had many different colors. But sometimes you want to use a very specific color to tell whether or not a solution is basic. And so here I have a basic solution. It looks like it could be some water, but I'm not going to drink it because that is a definite no-no in lab. You don't eat or drink or taste any of the chemicals. But other than this label, I have real no evidence to know that this is basic. So I can use what are called indicators that have a very specific color, that don't turn red and blue and yellow and all sorts of things. These are individual colors. I'm just putting a drop of each indicator into these empty beakers. One more for fun. All right. So really, I don't have very much in each beaker, but I have this liquid that says it's basic. Let's see, if I were to just pour water into these beakers, nothing would happen. However, since this isn't water, it is a basic solution. When I pour it in, it reacts with the indicator, the very specific indicator, to give us distinct colors. And you may notice a pattern in the order of which we decided to put the different indicators. So each one has a different color because they each have a different energy. Now, I think you are still going to change some different colors. Isn't that right, Tom?
Yeah, we're going to try a way of adding energy to matter using some flames. And you know, and you always, scientists want to be careful in the experiments that they do. And in the course of a demonstration, you also want it to be spectacular. And here is a new form of a flame test. This was actually helped develop by Caitlin Marler, one of our undergraduate students here at the U, who's just about to graduate. And what she did was actually take a trick out of Alfred Nobel's playbook. How did he make nitroglycerin safe for dynamite? He absorbed it on diatomaceous earth or even sawdust. And so we did the same thing where we absorbed on the alcohol in these flame tests on diatomaceous earth. And depending on the color that's there, the compound in the material, you get a different color. I think the yellow color, the orange color looks very familiar to all of us from a campfire. And that's largely due to sodium ion. The green in front is due to boron. The bluish green is very important to the Kennecott Copper Company due to a copper chloride compound. And the one that's sort of having a hard time is actually lithium. We really want you to see what lithium looks like. And so we're going to take advantage of actually a version of this flame test invented here at Utah by Professor Ragsdale, who loved, and Tom, you took chemistry.
I did.
Professor Ragsdale.
Absolutely. He was the great, yeah. We had a lot of fun.
And he always wanted to show the biggest demonstrations he could. And we're going to show you a video of this flame test as done a few years ago in the Faraday Lecture.
Now, color change is a great way, as Tom said, for us to have a window of something that's happening chemically. And if you look over there, there's a periodic table with a variety of elements in it, and every element is unique. Every element holds in its casing, if you will, a certain amount of energy. And depending on the levels of energy, they give off different colors. And so if we can turn down the lights, we'll see if we burn some of these elements, they might give off a different color. Now, again, let's predict what we might see or observe what we might see. So we see a nice green color, a nice orange color, but what color do we really like here at the University of Utah?
Red.
Red, exactly. And so you'll notice right here that this blue color is starting to get an inkling of red. And as we keep looking at it, the red overtakes the blue. So So as we can see from these different colors, different elements have different energy. And this experiment is really special because it was actually invented here at the University of Utah. Now, color change is a great way Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed that video. Now we're going to do a little bit of mad scientistry and create some more, let's say, shinier colors with some chemicals. In here I have some silver nitrate. Silver. I wonder what color we're going to be generating here. Doesn't look very silvery at this point, so let's do some reactions. I'm going to add ammonia. Woo! That is definitely ammonia. And it's going to get cloudy, so that's not so good. But we're going to keep adding the ammonia. Woo! Hopefully, there it goes. That cloudy color went away. Good. I'd like to put this cap on ammonia. So again, the bonuses of being on Zoom. So now I'm going to add potassium hydroxide. Oh, and that again doesn't look so like a good color, but going back to the ammonia, let's see if we can help this. So I started with silver nitrate, added ammonia, and now I'm adding, and then I added base and more ammonia to create a different type of silver reagent, so that I can do what's called a Collins test. Almost there. A little bit more.
And this is the Collins test?
It is.
Okay.
Now, I hear some recognition from Tom's voice. I remember the Collins test. That is a way to tell whether or not you have a functional group, specifically an aldehyde, in your compound. Almost. I don't know. Dr. Richmond, do you think this is clear enough?
I don't know. You're the silver expert.
True, but it usually gets a little bit clearer.
You want to give it a try? Yeah,
we'll try it. The nice thing about science is you can always do it again. All right, so I have this flask here. Now, this is dextrose. It's supposed to have aldehydes in it, but I can't tell. Nope, can't tell. So I can't look at a solution and know what functional groups are in it. Humans are fortunately not that good yet. But now that I've made effectively an indicator, if there are aldehydes in this, it will react with this Collins reagent. If we've done the chemistry right. And to be honest, sometimes it doesn't work right away.
I always think optimism is a good plan.
Yes, well, it is turning color, so that's always a good indication that reactions are occurring. And so it's definitely not clear anymore. It's turning a little bit more murky. We'll continue to rotate this. Went to brown, but now it's actually starting to look more metallic. Keep going. Now, if I wanted to speed this up, the best thing for me to do would have been to heat this flask up. Reactions usually go faster when they're heated up. And so this flask, as you can see, I'm touching it with my bare hand, is not very warm at all. But Dr. Richmond has so kindly turned on the heat plate, and we'll see if that, it's kind of like an oven though, it doesn't get hot right away. But we do have the magic of Zoom, and I'm gonna harness my inner Julia Child and ask you to continue to rotate this, and this is what it's supposed to look like after continuing to rotate the silver plates onto the glass. And you can imagine that this could be how Christmas ornaments are formed. And so I'm gonna keep working on this one while Tom does something else, so that we can keep this moving along. Because I just don't want to give up on this one yet.
That cloudiness is actually very finely divided silver particles that are nanoparticles. But you know what we want to do is, I'll take care of that, Janice. And I think you want to see if you can blow up a balloon.
Oh, yes, definitely. So I'm going to blow up. No, not that. That would just be way too ordinary. So I'm going to blow up a balloon simply by adding it to this bottle here. What do I mean by that? Well, I got to use some liquid nitrogen. I'm going to go around you, sir, right here. All right. So gases take up different volumes depending on the temperature they're at. And so if I put some liquid nitrogen, now you see smoke, but this is actually quite cold. I'm going to put some into the bottle as well, too. Into the bottle. And then I take this balloon, and let's see if I can add it to this top without ripping it. There we go. Yep. Okay. All right. So what I've done is I've cooled down the gas that's in the bottle with the liquid nitrogen. And so it's taking up less space. Think of yourself when you're cold. What do? You curl up into a ball, creating less space, and try to warm up. However, if I start to warm it up and it's already starting to expand, now the gas, the liquid nitrogen, is warming up because it's not surrounded by more liquid nitrogen. And this balloon, the gas in here, is starting to expand, push the balloon out, because it's warmer.
And not only that, if you think about a gas compared to a liquid, a gas takes up about 800 times the amount of space that a corresponding amount of liquid would. So think of this, we're making our own mini Goodyear blimp. And see, Tom is eyeing this kind of nervously as it gets bigger and bigger and bigger.
I'm just backing away.
But we're going to get Tom involved, because you've probably noticed these roses here. And as that expands, let's think about what happens if we cool matter way down. And so we have a large doer of liquid nitrogen. Grab a rose, Tom.
All right. I don't want to Watch out for the thorns so I don't prick myself here.
But let's see what happens
when
you put that into the liquid nitrogen. Just give it a good bath.
Just right here into this, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Go
the whole
it.
Thing?
Just go for it. Yep.
All right. Whoa. Hello. How long?
I'd let it get nice and cold. And the way we'll tell it's cold is when it stops boiling anymore. So we're cooling this liquid, this rose, down to minus 196 degrees centigrade, or 77 degrees above absolute zero, which is as cold as you can get.
Maybe the pink balloon will give you an indicator on when to take the rose out. A little signal.
Yeah, well, I'm by the pink balloon, I've got the rose here. So take it out yet?
Why don't you take it out and see what it looks like. See what it looks like. And it's okay to touch that rose.
With my hand?
Or your tongue, your choice. There's a really bad Christmas movie involving the tongue.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay. It's okay. Wow.
So we've basically...
So it kind of becomes paper-like.
Yep.
Yeah.
We've solidified a rose. Let's just do one more. But I'm getting a little nervous. Tom, what do you think about this guy?
Well, it seems to be getting bigger.
You know, I wonder if we could do a sort of an engineering test to see if there's any thorns on this rose.
Okay.
I think I see one there. This is nice and cold. We'll see what happens.
Whoa! Hello.
So that makes us all feel a little better. And now that we have a rose, we can shatter it because we've made it so brittle. And if you work at low temperatures, you have to have just the right materials to work at low temperatures. You know, this is sort of a problem for you and I, Tom, because I was sort of planning to take a few of these home to my wife.
Right.
I don't know if I should take home a frozen one, though. What do you
think?
No,
I don't think so.
Okay.
I don't think it's a good idea.
Well, Tom, why did you have roses in the first place? Is this could be...
Well, there is something going on, I believe, January 1st.
Oh, I think that is a very special day.
Yes, it is.
And we better find out if our audience is rooting for Utah or for Ohio State. So let's start that poll question. You get to vote for one or the other. They're both red. They're both good teams. Both were once coached by Urban Meyer.
That's right.
That's exactly so right. And so we'll see how this poll comes out. I suspect we're going to get a lot of responses here.
And this is what's going to happen to Ohio State's defense.
It's going to crumble.
They're going to be frozen as the U running backs just run right through them, correct?
That could be. Are you going to the game, Tom?
I am going to the game.
I thought so.
Yes.
That will be quite the event.
It will be great.
Oh, 6% Ohio State. That's
so
definitely higher than I thought.
6% must be from outside.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll see. So you saw Janis blew up a balloon using liquid nitrogen converting to a gas. I'm going to see if I can blow up a balloon using water vapor. So in this flask is a little water that we've warmed up on the hot plate. And as the water vapor warms up, the liquid water transforms into the gas phase. And essentially, we're going to remove all the gases from that flask except for water vapor. And so let's see what that might do if we cap it with the balloon. As we heat it up. So you can see the balloon is expanding and the water is boiling. You can see the condensation on the side of the flask. And you know, I'm not doing quite as well as Professor Louie did in terms of the size of the balloon. So I'm going to try to do something that might surprise you with this particular system. And I'm looking for is a little hand protection. Oh. I knew there was a glove here. So now I'm going to do my Michael Jackson impersonation. One glove. And that's probably lost on 95% of our audience. But we're going to cool this down in ice water. You guys make some observations about what's happening to the size of the balloon.
Down it goes.
because now all the gaseous steam is condensing back to water. The moon is shrinking. And shrinking. And shrinking. And whoa. Now we're blowing up a balloon in reverse. So we're essentially creating a vacuum as the water cools. Atmospheric pressure is pushing harder down on the balloon than the water vapor inside as this cools down. And so this is how you unblow up a balloon as this cools down. So we'll let that cool some more. And wait, you have more balloons?
I have more balloons. You know, we like to be festive here at the University of Utah. And if I let these go, they would, well, they're closed or they're open, so they would just release their gases. But if I tied a knot and let go, you'd see them float away because they're filled with what you would normally fill a balloon with. And that is something that is lighter than the air, helium gas, therefore making it float. But, you know, I have three. I feel like a hog. So, Tom, I'm going to share one with you. And, Tom, I'm going to share one with you as well, too.
Great.
You know, I don't know if you ever did this when you were at parties, but...
You're not going to make me tight.
Yes. No, I'm not going to make you tight. I'm going to make you drink the helium. So... We're going to explore what happens to our voice as it goes through something that is less dense than air. Is it going to go faster or slower? Now, helium is less dense than air. How about I go first, Tom?
Yes, please.
Okay. Me, I want a hula hoop. I think I sound exactly the same. What do you think, Tom?
Pretty much the same.
Yes. Nothing has changed. How about you, Tom?
I feel a lot lighter than air right now, and perhaps could be a munchkin or cartoon.
I
could be the world's biggest munchkin. How about you, Tom?
I think it's your turn.
Okay, just suck into it. Huh? Okay.
I am a Utah mandarin. I live across the green.
That was awesome.
What do you mean? This is fine. I'm just normal, right?
We're all normal. Now, as you can see, our voices got higher because going through the less dense helium, our sound waves went faster. And so, and there it goes. If you put a knot in it, it just floats away. Going through the helium, our voices got higher. Now, that's when something that is less dense. Oh, Tom, this balloon is clearly not filled with helium. It is filled with something much more pronounced. Tom.
A lot higher density.
Yes, higher density.
And it's a compound that's actually very important. It's used in the semiconductor industry and to protect electrical circuits. It's called sulfur hexafluoride. And I wonder what it'll do to my voice.
I don't think it changed at all. And although now I can be in the next Star Wars movie, perhaps as Darth Vader, but my real dream, going back to my adolescent years in junior high school, is I might be able to ask Professor Louie out for a date now.
That's on camera. You know that, Tom. Now, my voice is naturally higher than both of our Toms, and perhaps you didn't notice that much of a difference when I drank the helium, and Tom's voice is naturally deeper than mine, so perhaps you didn't notice a difference when he inhaled the sulfur hexafluoride, but what happens when I, with a higher voice, inhale the sulfur hexafluoride? We gotta put our science hats on and do the experiment.
I think, again, nothing has changed. I feel so powerful right now. So, so powerful.
Tom, what do you think?
Oh boy, here we go. Okay.
I don't think anyone told him about this in advance.
I don't think it's going to work.
You're right. Maybe we should work.
What's wrong with this? It doesn't work at all.
Speaking of not working, guess what? Our silver plating has started to actually plate. It just took a little bit of time. And Tom, do you have the other one so that they know that we didn't just say
I don't know where the other one went. It's got to be.
Yes, here it is. Right.
Our favorite elf.
So this one was our empty one that we showed you, but this one was the one that we created. You can see the solution in there. So it finally started to plate. So very appropriate for this holiday event. And speaking of holiday events, I think it's time to make some snow. Is that right?
Here we turn an aqueous solution into a metal. Let's see what else we can do with an aqueous solution. And this is a solution, it's called a super saturated solution of sodium acetate. So sodium acetate is just the salt form of vinegar. Another saturated solution you might be familiar with is the Great Salt Lake, saturated with salt. And
which technically this is a salt, just as
A little different salt. But this one's unusual that it needs instructions as to how to crystallize. Right now, the solution is very viscous, and there's an awful lot of sodium acetate in here. Let's see if we can create some snow by giving this, or even some ice, while giving this instructions.
Right, so I'm going to take a little bit, a very, very small amount of solid sodium acetate, hardly any. And let's see if this solid can instruct this liquid to turn into solid. And there it goes.
And, you know, one of the things, Tom, do you think that's hot or cold?
Cold.
Come feel it.
And it was quick, wasn't it? Boy, I tell you. Whoa. Yeah, it's hot. That's why I had struggling in chemistry.
So here we're going to see that this is reproducible. And obviously there was an awful lot of solid dissolved in a tiny bit of water. And you might have encountered this same thing, some reversible hand warmers are based on sodium acetate, where you crack a little disc inside that does the same thing that our seed crystal did, and then it releases heat over a period of time. So our snow was hot. This didn't make any sense.
Yeah, I know our snow is hot. You know, weather and chemistry, I mean, obviously we can use chemistry to make sense of weather, but it's kind of fun to think about creating snow, our own personal solid snow globes in the lab. It'd be really, really fun to create clouds inside here, but I don't think the technical team would appreciate that. So instead, what we're going to do is show you a video of how we can create clouds inside. I think here in Utah, when we think of different gases and different states of matter, what we are really famous for is snow. And where does snow come from? From clouds, exactly. And so let's see if we can generate some indoor clouds. I think we have some dry ice here and still some liquid nitrogen. The dry ice. Woo. So we're going to add some liquid nitrogen to it.
So we're taking something cold and making it even colder. But, you know, on an evening like tonight, I think we better warm things up just a little bit. And so let's add some energy to matter and see what happens.
So, Janis, how do chemists do chemistry without using chemicals? Is it possible?
That is a fascinating question, Tom, and it absolutely is possible. We do chemistry, the chemists do chemistry without chemicals by using the fastest computers in the world. We call it in silico. So in vivo is in real life, in vitro is in a flask, and in silico is in computers. So within the computer. And they use quantum mechanics, thermodynamics, statistical mechanics to predict, to calculate how atoms work and behave. In fact, I think we have some Oscar-worthy submissions from our theoretical chemists from our department.
Yes, it is time for the Video Film Festival. So we have three scientists right here from the University
right
of Utah.
From our
That's what I understand. Okay. And I'll probably botch their names and then they'll be mad at me, but I'll try my best. Michael Grinwald,
yes,
is going to do Metal Organic Frameworks 5, right?
Because you can't have just one.
You just can't have one. Okay. And then Valera Molinaro,
yes,
is going to do Ice at the Nanoscale. And then Jessica Swanson is going to do Understanding Biophysics. So what I want you to do is be watch the video. It's all kind of pieced together. And then you are going to be able to vote of which scientists you thought had the best experiment.
So that's
and
you, then, audience. You
that's
are
right.
going to be the judges.
That's them. That's
so
right.
We're going to take a poll at the end, so pay attention.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Michael. What you see in this image is what chemists call a metal organic framework. Metal organic frameworks are materials that are very porous. They contain lots of empty space. Because of all that empty space, metal organic frameworks can be used as molecular sponges. They can be filled with gases, for instance, with hydrogen gas to use it as a fuel, or to remove carbon dioxide from the air, or to capture drinking water in the desert. Metal organic frameworks are also crystals. They consist of ordered arrays of molecules that form microscopic cages. And the computer simulation that we are about to watch shows how such a crystal forms from a disordered solution of molecules. This process is called nucleation. The different colors in the movie tell us about the structure of the molecules. Blue means that molecules are disordered, but orange and green colors show two different types of crystal structures that the molecules could potentially form. The movie shows a tough competition between these two structures. Even though it first looks like the green crystal will form, it's the orange crystal that wins in the end. Let's take a look.
Yo, VIP. Let's kick it.
And that's it. Thanks for watching.
We started with a very basic question. How small can a particle be, can a droplet of water be, and still form ice? Ice one is the ice in the mountains. It's the first of all, because it's the ice that we see under normal conditions. And what we found somehow surprisingly is that the size of the smaller cluster that can make ice is pretty small. It's just 1 nanometer in diameter. And this 1 nanometer is something with less than 100 molecules, a millionth times smaller than a snowflake. But maybe the most interesting and revealing part about this is not the size. when the clusters are maybe 150 molecules and still you have ice well defined and it's becoming smaller, what you see is that the transition between ice and liquid changes in character. So this is the main finding of our study. We have seen this in simulations before, but actually not only we didn't have the experiments, but these experiments are extremely difficult to interpret. So the big challenge was to bring together the experiments that there were big developments to really get to sample the state of clusters that have 90 or 95 or 100 molecules. Thanks to the development of very accurate models of water, NVPOL, and also many techniques related to molecular simulations and spectroscopy, this was also huge. So essentially, we have a confluence of three different teams with complementary expertise, and now we can show it. Water on these smaller sizes, like a few, 1 nanometer of water, is not so unknown. So you can have sizes like these of water clusters inside proteins, maybe more significantly in the upper atmosphere. You have also these temperatures at which we find the transitions between ice and liquid at the smaller sizes. And these transitions in the upper atmosphere also happen with a very small cluster. So this could really help understanding ice-liquid transformations at very, very high altitudes.
Hello, Faraday audience. My name is Jessica Swanson. I am a theoretical chemist in the Department of Chemistry at the University of Utah. And today I wanted to show you a few movies that we make to give you an example of how we use computers to address questions about things that are medically important. And specifically, I was going to tell you about the story we've been working on lipid droplets. So lipid droplets, as you see here, are organelles that are in every cell, and they're responsible for storing fats. It may be obvious to some that issues with fat storage underlie many of the metabolic diseases we deal with in today's societies. So tissue lipotoxicity can lead to insulin resistance in diabetes, cardiomyopathies, and atherosclerosis. This is perhaps most obvious when we think about the extreme examples of lipodystrophy, when somebody is unable to store fats, versus obesity. Focusing on atherosclerosis, it's just one example, we know that lipid droplets play a central role. So this schematic shows how when monocytes are recruited to areas with high amounts of LDL, or low density lipoproteins, they absorb these lipoproteins and they convert their lipid droplets into cholesterol-rich lipid droplets. And this is essentially what turns macrophages, which you see here, into what we call foam cells. And this is really the beginning of plaque formation in atherosclerosis. What was predicted some time ago in 2008 is that when we have these high cholesterol levels, the lipid droplets undergo a transformation where they form these concentric rings. And just in 2019, experimentalists were able to image in vitro systems and in vivo systems with these concentric rings. So the question is, how do these concentric rings form and how does that influence the proteins that regulate the life cycles of fat storage? With all atom simulations, as I'm showing you here, we were able to capture for the first time this phase transformation from an amorphous or disordered lipid droplet. And what you're seeing here in the multicolors is all of the cholesterol and triglyceryl atom or molecules that are within the lipid droplet as they go from being unstructured to being perfectly aligned in these ring-like structures. This is what we call a smectic phase. And we were very excited to be able to capture this in simulations because phase transformations can be quite challenging. So this is very interesting and fun, but the relevance is in how it changes the surface properties of these lipid droplets, because surfaces is where the proteins come in to interact with lipid droplets. And this movie shows you an example of a glucose transcription factor called MLX that is known to target lipid droplets, but specifically only lipid droplets that are not rich in cholesterol. And so these movies show you how we can characterize the nature with which proteins target and associate with lipid droplets. The goal here is to understand these binding interactions and the mechanisms that enable them so that we can understand why some proteins do and some proteins don't target these lipid droplets that have undergone a phase transformation. And with that knowledge, hopefully develop therapeutics that will enable us to treat very challenging diseases like atherosclerosis. Thanks for your time.
Go over the nominees again. Michael Grunwald on the metal organic frameworks 5. Valera Moreno, ice at the nanoscale, and Jessica Swanson, understanding biophysics. We'll give you about 30 seconds. Go take your vote and let's see who is going to win.
Actually, do we have a prize for
the winner? I was looking for a little Oscar statue, but that might be not inclusive type of victory. We'll have to think about that.
Yes, maybe I'm a sure frozen rose.
A frozen rose.
How about they get to inhale that balloon?
Yeah.
Because we want our theoretical chemists to do experiments. And they will tell you, by the way, that what they do with computers is every bit as rigorous as the experiments we might do in beakers. Sometimes it's even more rigorous.
Absolutely. It's just not as messy.
Are we there?
Yes. it's a tie.
Should we go a little longer? We're going to go a little longer because we got a tie. So let's go a little longer.
Is that what happens in the Oscars? That if there's a tie, they go a little longer?
We just don't want to announce the wrong name. Okay, so I got to go find out who is the winner. Still a tie?
I don't mind having two winners.
So who are the winners? Let's see, drum roll.
Okay, you ready?
Yes, sir.
The winners are Jessica Swanson and Michael Grunwald.
Woohoo! Yay! Yay!
Very, very good.
That is great.
Okay, I think we're going to get to a poll question again. So are you ready with your poll question? Ready? Go. Here's the question. How many people are watching with you? We knew that there was the 80-20, about 80 in Utah, 20 outside of Utah. But now we want to also ask, are you watching with anybody? So how many people are watching you this presentation with you? So we'll give another 30 seconds.
And while you're counting the large number of people in the room, you might also be sneaking out for a snack. And, you know, food is another, and metabolism is another example of a chemical reaction. And we're going to explore one of the really important food groups in our lives, chips, and see how they behave once this poll closes. All right. So, you know, when you read the label on the back of one of these bags and it tells you the nutrition facts, the one that always disturbs me is when it says 8 chips are a single serving size. And so let's look at the behavior of some chips. This is a full fat tortilla chip. It looks like an emergency candle as it burns, but since the corn chip is not a very good conductor of heat, my hand isn't getting hot, and now I have a place to dump the corn chip in a second. But this is what a normal full-fat corn chip looks like when you burn it. These might be a little healthier. These are just pita chips. Let's see how they behave. Smelling some weirder smells, but these have a little less fat content. They're still burning, because carbohydrates burn as well. Looks like it's picking up speed. But again, this is the essence of metabolism, taking sugars and carbohydrates and turning them into CO2 and water. And I'm kind of embarrassed to say there was a bag of pork rinds at my house. Let's see how one of those burns. Of course, pork rinds are exactly what they say. So I don't think this experiment has ever been done in the Faraday lecture.
Oh, I can hear it.
Yeah.
And as it keeps going, yeah, it really
crackles.
So there's really, and of course, fat is the largest source of carbohydrates. Carbohydrates are basically half-burned fats. They have one oxygen in them for every carbon. And so that's why when you eat candy that says fat-free, well, you're eating a lot of sugar. But can we do metabolism in a better way or burn things a little more energetically?
I think so. In fact, unfortunately, since Tom said more energetically, that means not in this beautiful Curie Club here at the department. Instead, what we're going to do is show you a video of a more pronounced oxidation or metabolism of a Jolly Rancher being exposed to energy.
Another way to oxidize organic compounds. This is the holiday season, and so we think about candy a lot, don't we?
Yes, yeah, so the burning of the... So the burning of the chip is slow because oxygen is a very slow reactant, a very slow oxidizer. And what Jeff is doing right now is liquefying a much stronger oxidizer. And so we're gonna take candy that may have some calories in it and see what happens. This is a Jolly Rancher. What happens when we do the same oxidation in metabolism a little bit faster?
So that's just one piece of candy. Look at all the energy it's producing.
Good thing this doesn't happen in our stomachs.
It's in there.
I thought you said it's 6.5.
Yeah, Yeah, I think you have it 6.5. What does it say?
Oh,
or 65.
You just said you had a 6.5 earlier. So, welcome back. The fun of Zoom. Now, we talked about burning organic compounds. My favorite is actually to connect organic compounds and really make bonds. The bonds that we're going to make, I'm going to have my two Toms race, and that is to make a polymer. Now, what I want you to envision is a seventh grade dance, and all the girls are on one side, and all the boys are on the other side, and the music starts to play. What do the girls and boys do? They stand by the wall, and they kind of sway. Everybody wants to dance, but nobody is really has the, let's say, the initiative to start dancing. However, once the music starts going some more, you have them mixing up. Now I want you to picture now they're all mixing up, and every girl is holding a boy's hand on each side, and every boy is holding a girl's hand on each side. And if the whole room did that, we'd have one big human chain. That's really what a polymer is, a big chain of monomers. So instead of boys and girls, you have monomers creating the chain. And so I have monomer A and monomer B with monomer A and monomer B and Tom A and Tom B. Oh, no. So they're going to demonstrate creating that polymer.
And Tom's, all you have to do is pour one into the other.
It doesn't matter which one
I put in first. It doesn't matter which one. It's a little sticky.
And then
sticky.
I just stir.
You just
go stirring.
Stir crazy. Exactly.
Okay, don't.
Oh,
okay.
Tom, Dr. Richmond tried to beat you by starting ahead.
You can't do that.
Starting ahead. I'm going to move this one out of the way.
Come on, baby.
Keep it in the middle. Oh, yeah. And you want your left hand out of the way once it starts foaming. There it is. There it is. Yes, I think.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh, yep.
Now, normally we have people cheering for us.
Go, Tom, go! Go, Tom, go! Wait a minute.
Come on, come on. And of course, polyurethanes are one of the big chemicals used in construction to make insulation and keep things...
Woo, I'm getting tired, but it's okay.
You need some of those pork rinds.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, I'm about ready to call it and... I got the good one. I got the red one. We just added a little dye to this, and then we'll give these guys.
Oh, I think. Yep.
Okay. Oh,
it's coming
there,
over.
Yep.
Okay.
And just go ahead. Take. Nope. Go ahead.
Okay.
Yep. Now you might think that the one on the left, which looks like a, not red one, that maybe there was some spillage, but you can see now that they're both overflowing. So they're increasing in volume as the individual monomers start linking up with each other. They are creating something that is more expanded. And this is going to continue to expand over time. So,
maybe other polymers that are kind of important
are
used in all sorts of chemistry.
Great.
And
I am going to do a similar demonstration, very much more smaller scale. And so again, I have monomer A and monomer B, and we're going to have each monomer A hook up with two Bs, and each B hook up with two As, and they're going to create a chain. And this is kind of hard to see because they're both colorless. So I'm going to add a dye to one. Open this. There we go. There. So one layer now is pink. Let's put this on this white sheet right here. Thank you, sir. Right here. And the other layer we're going to keep clear. And the reason I say layers is because rather than mix them up at first, I'm going to simply put the clear layer on top of the pink layer, not mixing the two liquids together. We're still separating the boys from the girls. And so you see a clear layer on top of the pink layer. However, at the interface, they're starting to react. So I pull from the interface, I've created a solid from all the A's linking up with all the B's. And if I just continue pulling, that interface is going to continue creating a polymer. And this polymer is actually nylon. Which some
go higher up?
Wow.
Yes, absolutely.
And it's pretty hard, right?
Yeah, so nylon, of course, is used in all sorts of things. The same bonds that we're creating in nylon are the ones that hold together the parts, the chemical parts of a bulletproof vest or Kevlar in high-end bike tires, getting flats. And so a lot of this is actually one of the stronger structural polymers depending on the components of the nylon.
Exactly. Clothing. Now, this is not something that I would want to wear, personally. And so I could go on and just create a whole, let's say, yarn thing of nylon. But instead, what I'm going to do is just dump it right in, and you can see that I'm creating a big mass of polymer.
Wow, that's cool. And a lot of the time when chemists make polymers, they use catalysts to speed up the reaction and produce a particular product. And we'd like to introduce you to a good friend of ours.
Yes, one of my closest friends.
Henry the Hydrogen. And in this video, it's far too loud to do in this room, we're going to try to understand how palladium, one of the most important metals used in catalysis and in the catalytic converter of your car to make drugs and other important organic compounds, you're going to see how palladium can start a very loud reaction. And one of the things that chemists do is develop new and clever ways to control reactions using catalysts. And we're going to see if a catalyst is effective. So here's a bottle that contains a highly flammable and explosive even mixture of hydrogen and oxygen.
Oh my God.
But apparently, just dropping it wasn't enough. Didn't put enough energy in to make these molecules react. It may have made a few of you react, but that's one of the fun things about teaching, is having reactive students. And what we want to explore is if we can start this reaction not with a flame, but with a catalyst. You all drove here in a car with a catalytic converter. And we're going to explore that same metal, palladium. It's famous for a lot of reasons in Utah. So let's add that to our flask. And you notice we're both putting on ear protection. We've already talked about Star Wars, so pretend you're Princess Leia. So again, we asked the scientists in a room, did a chemical reaction take place?
You know, the nice thing about reactions is that usually they go faster or more stuff happens the more reactants you put in it. And so I think we have a bigger bottle that has more of this reaction mixture in it. So let's see what happens when we add the same amount of catalyst.
This is the true story of Henry the Hydrogen. Henry was an average diatomic hydrogen molecule. He was light on his feet and fairly stable, but felt that there was a lot more potential within him. You see, most hydrogens he knew were no longer diatomic molecules. They had grown, and as they do, found other atoms to bond with. Henry always figured he would react someday, but as time went on, he started to wonder when it would happen. One day, while talking to Harold, a hydrogen friend of his, he heard that it took a lot of energy to open yourself up to meeting someone. "It's like pulling yourself apart," his friend said. This didn't sound like a lot of fun to Henry, and he started to wonder if he would ever have the courage to go for it. There would really have to be quite the spark to give him the energy he needed. But then Harold mentioned a party he heard about. "It's supposed to be a great place to meet reactants. I'm planning on going. I hear a lot of oxygens are going to be there." This made Henry very excited. He had had his eyes on one oxygen in particular, Olivia, but she was always with her clingy friend. Not very approachable, these two. "I don't know," Henry stammered, still unsure of himself. "Let's just go. This DJ gets everyone dancing whether they want to or not." A few days later was the day of the party. It was in sort of a strange building, but whatever. Once inside, they were a little disappointed. There were plenty of gases there, hydrogens and oxygens, but there wasn't any energy in the room. They were just pacing around and making awkward conversation. This is supposed to be the great party we've heard so much about. Henry was about to suggest they leave when he saw Olivia across the room. He thought about talking to her, but there just wasn't enough energy. Just then, it happened. Palladium showed up. Before anyone knew what had happened, they were all dancing and mingling like crazy. Henry was introduced to Olivia within the blink of an eye, and they hit it off immediately. It's like that energy barrier wasn't even a problem anymore. All the hydrogens and oxygens found love that day, and will live happily as compounds until electrolysis do they part. All thanks to palladium.
Okay, we're back, right?
Yes, in fact, check out your hats, Tom. You did it.
I think I won.
I think you did.
And
you did.
These are hard.
Yeah, they're no longer liquid because as a polymer, they increase their strength and more bonds that they make, right? And so you made a lot of bonds and you increased the strength here. And I think this is lovely on you.
But I got a little feather in my hat.
That's right.
Forget that.
Exactly. So, Janis, you're kind of a TV star.
I wouldn't say a TV star.
No. Well, she was on a special, correct?
Yes.
Well, I mean, because I've been really fascinated by all of this chemistry experience, and I think you were able to kind of share it with some people on the show. Do you want to tell us
Absolutely.
About it?
Absolutely. Okay. I had the great fortune of being chosen to be an then ambassador for the AAAS, who through the generosity of Lyda Hill, created an ambassadorship to increase the representation of females in science and to really showcase the diversity of what a scientist looks like. Now, we can think of us, when you say the word scientist, a stereotype tends to pop into your head. However, scientists, as you can tell even tonight, look very different and span all sorts of skills and hobbies, and one of mine is martial arts. And in this clip that we're going to show you, we'll show how sports and science really go hand in hand together to really try to create, to strive for better things. And we're going to show that now.
Master martial arts and a special person to master chemistry. What if I told you that sometimes it's the same person? Like Professor Janis Louie. Nabil has the story.
I'm here in beautiful Salt Lake City about to meet with chemist Janis Louie, and we're gonna talk about solutions. Although, feels like this is a martial arts studio. Well, let's see what she has in store for me.
Meet Janis Louie, University of Utah chemistry professor and martial artist who is not only breaking boards, but also the stereotypes that exist around chemistry.
A lot of people think that if you are into science, you're not into sports and vice versa, but they actually go hand in hand.
As Janis puts me through the ringer, I really start to wonder, how does this have anything to do with chemistry?
Worked up a sweat. How about you?
Me too.
Awesome, because that's the chemistry I wanted to show you today. We lose water and electrolytes from sweating, and we need to replenish them. How do you think we'd do that, Nabil?
By drinking water or a sports drink?
Yes, and those are chemistry too. Would you like to make some?
Yeah.
Awesome. Let's follow me.
Chemistry!
Welcome to my Dojang laboratory, Nabil.
This looks awesome.
Well, we're gonna make some sports drinks, but first, what do you think a sports drink is, Nabil?
Water with a bunch of stuff dissolved in it? That's good for you?
Absolutely. You just described what a solution is.
A solution can be a gas, liquid, or solid. The air we breathe, the gasoline we put in cars, and even steel are all examples of solutions.
So, pop quiz. Do you know what an electrolyte is?
Oh, well, I know that they're like salts.
Absolutely. You said the magic word, salts. So they're charged molecules. That means these sports drinks conduct electricity.
What?
The positive and negative ions that make up salt create a pathway for electricity to flow. To demonstrate this, we've created a device using a battery, a Christmas light, and tin foil. Since electrolytes carry electricity, if the light glows, the solution has them.
I guess that's why they call it electrolytes.
Mm-hmm. Janis explains that you can't just dump any solid into a liquid and call it a solution. Watch what happens when we pour sand into water.
It's not dissolving, is it?
No, not at all.
No, not at all, exactly.
In order for a compound to dissolve in a liquid, you have to break the ionic bonds. In our case, we have to break sodium chloride into its individual ions, sodium, Na, and chloride, Cl. And water has the ability to do that.
Mix.
You truly look like a mad scientist, Nabil.
I really feel like one.
Do you notice any changes?
The salt's gone.
That's a solution right there. See, we can't tell that there's a solid and a liquid combined in here. It just looks like a liquid. You ready to make a sports drink?
Yes.
For my sports drink, I'm adding a cup of limeade, a cup of water, and a quarter teaspoon of magnesium chloride, which is a type of salt.
Is it time for a taste test?
Let's do it.
All right, cheers.
Cheers. That's great.
That's chemistry.
Janice has certainly made me a fan of chemistry. And she hopes to inspire other young people to believe that they too can be scientists.
Chemistry was really hard for me at first. I worked really hard, then everything just clicked. I think the young people of today should remember that it's okay to struggle and to be confident and say to themselves, I can do this. I'm smart enough. In fact, I'm more than smart enough.
Thank you so much, Janis, for having me. I had an incredible day. And you're right, chemistry is everywhere, from the moves that we make, to the sweat that we produce, to the drinks that we drink. I mean, I kind of don't want to leave. Can I just stay here and break some more boards? I mean, bonds?
Absolutely. In fact, why don't we go break some boards right now? Yeah.
Hi.
Do you love videos like this? Or how about this?
Welcome back. I hope you had fun visiting our dojang. And so now where I want you to visit is this really special place here at the University of Utah, and that is the Crocker Science Building.
Do you want me to do this one?
That really came apart of one of the things that we wanted to increase, which is our undergraduate research initiative here at the University of Utah. It's called the Science Research Initiative, and it allows all of our science undergraduates an opportunity to get involved with research. And this is something that really flips the switch, or ignites a fire, if you will, of our undergraduates really believing that they can be scientists. So why don't you watch this and learn about our SRI.
Three, two.
When you are able to take an idea from the abstract all the way through the implementation of a very tangible thing like a space launch.
Fire. Touchdown confirmed. We're safe on Mars.
There's no greater reward in science or in engineering. What the Science Research Initiative aims to do is connect entering students, entering freshmen, entering transfer students, to those transformative undergraduate research experiences from the first day that they set foot on campus. Donations that come into the SRI, they go directly to student scholarships. It allows students to stay on campus engaged in the SRI rather than having to go off campus and ring up a cash register and in a part-time job.
Without the scholarship that I've been given, I could not be doing everything that I'm doing in college. I couldn't be as involved as I want to. I wouldn't have been able to fully dedicate myself to my studies and keep up my good grades and research and be involved with student organizations. The scholarship gives me freedom to explore within the college and just really get the fullest experience that I can.
I wouldn't be able to be in the lab every day. I would be too busy worried about working or, you know, providing for myself in other ways. The scholarship makes all the difference.
It's such an impactful program. Your donation can go directly to students to participate in the Science Research Initiative and take advantage of this impactful research program that really will launch them on their career trajectories.
Okay, we're back. It's pretty neat that those undergraduates get those opportunities. But I'm wondering, in these experiments, have you ever had one that just never worked?
Well, you know, part of doing research is failure. And one bit of research I did for the Faraday Lecture was attempting to guillotine a cell phone battery. And our machine shop built a nice guillotine for a cell phone battery, and I wanted to see, I'd seen a picture of this, I wanted to do it for the Faraday Lecture. And we're going to show you the video where, in practice, it worked.
All right, here we go. Let's see if anything happens. Well, we certainly stabbed it. Did we go through it?
Yeah, see, there's
oh, there it goes. Yeah.
Let's see. A little time delay.
Okay.
Oh, Nelly. I wouldn't have expected that.
That works.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, so the only
So we can improve continuity, I guess.
Well, that's not bad, actually.
That's not bad.
I mean, it's a
spectacular. The reason we showed you that one is, well, it's hard to do here in this setting, and as Tom Thatcher asked us, were there ever any things that didn't work? And that was an experiment that Tom and I tried multiple times in front of the audience, and they just did not give us the results that they wanted.
We just saw a little smoke, but no fire, and not that nice red streak indicative of lithium ion. But I wonder if this demonstration
I think so, yes. So one of the reasons why I became a chemist was not to blow things up. In fact, in my research, if things explode, that's usually a bad sign that things are not working. Why I become a chemist, one of the things that I liked about science was that things change color. Now these, again, aren't very colorful. However, if I pour these clear liquids together, you'll notice a reaction occurring, and color change is one indication that it reacts. Now you'll notice that at first it went orange, but now it's blue. I'm going to give it a little swirl, It's going to stay blue, but then it's going to go back to orange. So you might think it's done. But it's not done. It turns blue again. Let's see. Is it done now? I'm not sure. I don't think so. It goes back and forth between orange, my favorite color, and blue. That's why this is called an oscillating clock, because it oscillates between the orange color and the blue color, both of which come from different reactions. So there are three reactions going on, and if as we get to a certain concentration, all the color changes to the other compound as the reaction occurs.
Wow, that one worked. And you know, I think we should end though with a little fire and a little light. And so what we have here is a large flask filled with oxygen. And I'm going to take this sample of sulfur, which is yellow, and light it on fire. And you might be able to see it's turning sort of red and gooey as it gets on fire, and then there's a little flame. But if I put it in pure oxygen, we now have a faster reaction with oxygen and a really nice, gentle blue flame that I hope you can see. In fact, in a sulfur mines, when they get set on fire by accident, they actually burn with this same blue but gentle flame. And it looks like we're just about ending out. There's a little smoke and haze. When you burn sulfur, that produces sulfur dioxide. I'm not too concerned about sulfur dioxide as a chemical because we use that as a preservative for grapes and dried fruit and the like. And even some bottles of wine, they say, contain sulfites. And we're getting just kind of I've never seen this one go quite like this, a little flashing blue reaction as the haze, and that keeps changing color.
I know, yours is petering out, but mine's still going strong here. It's been oscillating away next to yours.
And so we're gonna give this just a second more, and then we'll close this season's first virtual edition of a Faraday lecture. If you stay on the line or pick up the recording later, you're going to see a few of our more spectacular demonstrations after we close, as well as a word about safety.
Yes.
Because we're actually
professionals.
And we do things in a safe and we hope an effective but fun manner. So this is always one of the highlights of my year. And we're going to try
Mine
to
too.
Finish by, ooh, look at that. Doing better. By quenching the reaction, and then to understand what's going on with the chemistry. We're starting out green. Let's see what happens.
There's that universal indicator again.
And so I hope you can see the Christmas colors due to chemistry.
Oh, yes. Very good. Well, thanks everyone. We pulled it off, I guess, huh? We want to just thank everyone here on our staff. We've got a great production staff that you don't see right now, but they've made all of these things kind of just go seamless.
And we also want to thank Jeff Statler, who is really the man behind all of the chemistry. He does most, if not all, of the legwork of really putting the reactions together so that Tom and I can really just play.
Oh, yeah. And then Caitlin, who's our assistant there, who's made everything very possible too, the Department of Chemistry, and of course you too. Now, do we still have one more experiment? Because with you being a black belt, right, are you going to like?
Yes, I'm going to, Miyagi Karate Kid tonight. Because again, we are in a place that I want to respect the furniture.
Thank you.
So enjoy the rest of our videos and have a wonderful
Thank
holiday
you.
Season.
Thank
Appreciate
you for joining
Appreciate everybody.
Us.
Merry Christmas. Be safe.
Come to my chemistry classes sometimes is to see this next reaction. It's called a thermite reaction. It might involve some heat, it might involve some light. Let me orient you. This is a metal pan, and in our crucible is a mixture of iron oxide or rust, and that same metal we were familiar with early on, aluminum. And we're going to see what happens if we get this reaction started.
Fireworks.
The last part of that reaction has been done hundreds of times in Salt Lake City when they were putting together the track system. This is how you still weld together the rails on light rail so you don't get a clickety-clack of railroads. The product is glowing. It's molten iron. But first, let's see how my metal pan did. Not very well. And then, just so you can see that this has produced tremendous amount of heat, in this ingot, the iron is still molten, kind of like at the center of the Earth. And a lot of heat that warms us up. Let's see how magnesium reacts by burning it. And so magnesium gives off a very bright light as it burns. And I'm going to try to get more of this magnesium to burn. In this case, the magnesium is sitting on a block of dry ice. And I'm going to heat up this sample a little bit. And we know carbon dioxide can act as a fire extinguisher. So we'll try to test that out with magnesium. So when it's not near the dry ice, it starts burning. I'm going to try to snuff this fire out with another block of dry ice. Is something happening?
Wait, Tom, I thought you were putting the fire out.
Obviously, my next career will not be as a fireman. Carefully, besides, I can run little races with my liquid oxygen molecules. You can see it's a very faint blue color. And I'm just using it to displace all the air, so I'll have essentially pure oxygen in my flask. But I want to wait for it to all evaporate. And you can see there's just a little bit of frost forming on the thing because it's getting kind of cold. But now I've filled this up with oxygen, and I'll just let the last little bit drain out. What I'm going to do is try a reaction with phosphorus. And like most reactions, we'll need a little heat to get things going. And so I'm going to warm this rod up and take my piece of phosphorus, and I'm going to put it inside my flask with oxygen. And then to get the reaction started, I'm just going to warm up the phosphorus a little bit. And you can see a chemical reaction is taking place that is not only emitting heat, but light, hence the name phosphorus. But I want to learn more about this solution. The compound that forms here, some of you had had a drink of today. It's in Coca-Cola. So let's see if it acts as an acid or a base by using one of our indicators. And this, I think, is a kind of a fun reaction for Christmas. Have you guys seen any color changes? And so just like Coca-Cola, we have an acidic solution formed from the oxidation product of phosphorus.
Welcome to the University of Utah Faraday Chemistry Lectures.
You may not know it, but chemistry is everywhere.
If you can see, hear, touch, feel, or taste it, that's chemistry.
Please join us for an exciting evening of experiments, fun, and learning at the Faraday Lectures. We've had a lot of fun together this evening.
But remember, chemistry can be dangerous. All of the experiments tonight have been done in a controlled, safe environment.
Please do not try these at home.